today to share a bit more. So unlike what Leon does, actually a lot of our things are a little less, I would say, like non-functional, or rather more on the aesthetic side of things. They look good, they look cool, we spend a lot of time surface finishing. So that'll be the basis of what I'll share a little bit more today, alright? So we're not going to be talking a lot about what printing is, what are the technical details, but first I'd like to do a little introduction of what we, who we are, what we do. So this is a kind of a snapshot of our, one of the sites of our studios. We run 4 machines now, getting a few more. So most of the things we like to do big. We print big pieces by actually creating smaller subsets of them, smaller components, and then assembling them. So for us, a lot of projects that we work on entails things like stuff like that, right? They tend to be a little bit larger, a little bit more grandiose. We like things to be larger. And we actually end up having to spend a lot of time actually combining parts, doing a lot of surface finishing, and then doing some color work, paint, stuff like that, and then the detail finishing. Okay? So these are the kind of stuff we do. You see a lot of props involved there, because we're great lovers of pop culture. A lot of projects that we help people off are also like very pop culture related. So that's what we do. Okay. So this is roughly some of the techniques that I might share today. All the way from how do you get pieces joined together, after that how do you send them, some parts about filling gaps when you have created parts from many smaller parts, right? And then finally painting and detailing work, so I just go through that. Looks a bit dry when I put it out like that, but let me first very quickly show you the toolkit we use. So flipping the camera around, just now you saw the picture of the printers. When you turn around, this is what our kind of toolkit looks like. All the various equipment, supplies that we use. So kind of going one by one, normally we have some of the regular craft supplies like cups and general protection like gloves that sometimes we also don't really use. For sanding, we use a lot of different grids of sandpaper, all the way from 120 grit all the way down to about 500, 600 or even in certain cases, 1200, 2000 grit kind of sandpaper. Then obviously to join pieces together, we need to use many different kinds of glues and adhesives. Sometimes we are a bit lazy, we just use the regular super glue. You can buy it easily. There's really no difference between brands. Other times we want a stronger bond, we'll use things like epoxy and things like that. So those two parts you mix together, A and B parts you mix together, you bond it together, sometimes we clamp it, and it gives you a really, really strong bond. Okay? Other tools that we use, putties and solvents. So after your glue pieces, like I said, you need to do a bit of surface finishing work. For 3D printed parts, when you first print it off the machine, they look like, if you look closely, there are layer lines to them. So they're ridges, very small ridges. So a lot of times we want to get rid of them, we'll actually apply a thin layer of putty and let it dry, it'll fill in the gaps and then sand it. Other times we might use epoxy resins like XTC to apply a thin coat, let it dry, and do the same sanding again, all for the purpose of getting a smoother finish. So these are what we use. Solvents are there to actually thin down some of the parties that we use, and also the thin pins, depending on what we're doing. Then on the rightmost are really all the paints that we use, ranging from things like hand paints, typical, let's say the acrylic paints that you'll find, very cheap kind of stuff, gets the job done, all the way to the more hobby grade paints, like the Timiers, that you get, you spray, you get good color, coverage, things like that. Then other stuff that we do would be, sometimes before you paint on the raw piece, you need to prime the surface, so a lot of different kind of primers, gloss, non-gloss, matte, black, white, gray, we have all sorts. And then finally, all the color sprays and special effects sprays. So I realized that could have been a bit boring. So let's talk about some of the techniques that we have. Oops, too fast. So I said parting and sanding. So we have some pieces here. I'll just use this like an example, it's more interesting. This one, any of you recognize what this is?
This Reaper's mask.
Reaper's mask, that's right. This is from Overwatch, okay? So this is one of the pieces, we didn't design this one, but we benefited from someone who did and shared it online. So if you, I flip to the back, you'll see the most important thing is, you see, hey, well, there's autograph here. The developer autograph for us, okay, I'm just kidding. That's not the thing. What I wanted to show you is, if you turn to the back, this piece is a very large piece. Most of the printers you have at home will likely not be able to print this size. Or even if it could, it'll take really, really long. So instead, what most people do when they design prop pieces, or even for us, would be to actually separate it so that you have something like, I don't know, this feels like maybe 6 or 7 pieces that you then subsequently glue together and then do the drawing work. So I'm not sure the difference. Later you guys can come to the front and have a closer look. But if you look to the back, we deliberately left it unfinished except for gluing, so you can see all the lines pretty clearly, right? But if you look at the front, that's where we've done a lot more of the parting work. So where there were lines on the front between the parts where the pieces came together, we simply parted it, sanded it down so that the lines go away as much as we can, and then we did a spray painted over it. Actually, this was a really rough job that Jeanette sended. Really, for a really long time. Because we were rushing for the launch of Overwatch at the time. So this is pretty cool. So the one on the right, you can see, is another part that I'm working on right now. It's part of a robot from a game called 1+4. And as you can see, it's not as well sanded. But just to give you a taste of how we do it, we normally send it to the box because particles do fly everywhere, right? And after you get a piece of jointed, let's say this is a raw piece, although it has been jointed together by super glue, parted, sanded down, we do need to then get the paint on it. Because typically we'll do it in a white color. We paint all in white, and then we have to prime it. So priming will look something like that. Priming is actually a kind of a spray that you apply first on the raw plastic to allow the subsequent layers of paint to adhere better to it. If you had sprayed or hand brush directly on, let's say the plastic, raw plastic, it's very likely that you'll chip and stuff like that. And the colors may or may not be that vibrant. So that's what we do. So kind of like a step one, step two, the top pictures are the examples of pieces that have been primed. Normally we'll prime it in black or gray, and then subsequently we'll paint it. So the one on the bottom right is a Merlion piece actually sculpted by Arthur over there. We have the piece here too, right up front. So later you can have a closer look how it got from really a raw printed part into one that's finished very nicely. Actually the finishing done by Sean, it's the thing over there also. Can we put this down? Okay, so, but really more I want to use the second half of the presentation to share more about the project, one of the projects that we have done, Torbjörn's Turret, which is from a game called Overwatch. It's really over there right now. I haven't really assembled it because it's not the most sturdy in the world. It might actually drop over. But just to give a quick introduction, this is a game called Overwatch. So this full disclaimer, not being paid to actually promote it here. But we play a lot, we like the game a lot. And this is one of the favorite characters that at least I played because it's such a cheapskate character. You can get a lot of wins by it. Okay? So this is Torbjörn. So I like using him a lot, and you can see he also likes us. He put our logo here.
What?
Joking. Okay. So Torbjörn, he loves his turret. So it's one of the kind of in-game mechanism that he has. He builds a turret, it shoots at people, just to give a background of it, right? So we looked at it and say, hey, that's really cool. Can we actually bring that into real life, right? And the good thing about it, and the really cool thing about Blizzard is that they actually released a lot of the design files. Actually, this was, I think, officially released as not design files, but so-called the schematics, at least the illustrations of it. They released it, and a lot of people through either like gameplay, right? Or maybe some of them did their own fan art. They started to draw different views of it, different ideas or different angles of it, right? So the first thing when we do in starting a new project, something like that, is that we'll kind of consolidate as many references as we can get. Because you really don't want to be modeling halfway and then turn to the back and wondering what it's like at the back, right? So the first thing that we do in a lot of projects, we get the references, then subsequently we start to model. So without going a lot into the technical details of how modeling is done, what we start with, essentially we'll just use references from the side, maybe from the front, from the top, which was Facebook, we saw earlier. This is actually a zoom in version of this one, right? Which gives a lot of different views of the object we want to model. From there, we actually model it in 3D software. For us, actually, we just use a software called Rhino, and that's what it looks like in the end, after many hours of work. And after we have modeled it, what we'll do is, because once again, we're printing big, printing very big. That is actually, I think, about 1/4 the scale of the actual scale. Initially, we wanted to print live scale, which would be about like that. And then I calculated the print time and say, forget it, we have other things to print. So we printed 1/4 scale. So after we have the 3D model, we need to start thinking about how do you disassemble for printing. And part of that entails thinking about or considering how we would disassemble so that it's easier to paint, it's easier to then maybe take apart when we want to move it around, right? Like so. So from that model you saw earlier, this one, that's a finished model. We actually had to break it down into parts like that, with the primary concern being that it had to fit the printer, or at least most printers. So we worked with a bounding box of 20 by 20 by 20 cm, and that's pretty standard for most 3D printers that people have, right? So we break up the parts. You see some parts like that, where we have kind of like a pack and pull mechanism that allows us to create some mobility in the joints also, so parts will swivel. Okay? So after that, after I think a glorious 180, 200 plus hours of printing, then it comes to the tedium of assembling and sending. So these are what halfway through the process things will start to look like. We have raw pieces joined together by super glue, and the grey parts you see over here and on that side are really the putty. We use this grey colored putty that we then have to send out. It takes a lot of time to do that. After sending. So this is more of the next step of how pin work happens. On the left side, you'll see all the different color parts. Because we're using many printers to print it, we're using different color filaments, we don't really care what color it comes out to be, because we're going to paint it in the end, right? So these are all the various parts before assembly, and I do have some raw parts over there, so we can have a look later. And after painting, they will come to something that looks like that. Obviously, after priming and painting. So this is what I mentioned, the movable leg joints. So to give it, to make it a little more interesting also, not so much that the whole piece is one solid part, doesn't move, we gave it some movable parts like that. So we had to calculate tolerances on how to have the pack go through the hole, being snug enough, but still easy to remove, or even easy to assemble in the first place. Okay. And one of the little tricks that we use is, I'll draw a quick comparison. For this part, this pack that goes through the hole to hold the armor in place, it was actually 3D printed, because we wanted a certain size to it. But we did have other internal components, kind of scaffolding that holds the tiles together, that did not have to have a certain dimension. So as a kind of a shortcut, we actually use PVC patch instead. So these are really cheap, and it's really easy to cut, and very strong. And when we need to move it around, it's easy to pull things apart, put them together again, it's very light kind of material. So that's what we use for a lot of the skeletal components of our projects. Then obviously after we've printed, the most important part, or the most fun part, is to bring it out, put it on display, show cool folks like yourself what it looks like. And this is one of the times when we brought it to, I think, GameStart, one of the conventions. Then I think a lot of people had a ball with it. So that's what we do. Yes, and that's all I have. So I'll happy to take questions if there's any.
Send first before you prime.
Yes, we do send first before we prime. Yeah. So we normally will send it down, to, at least for me, for that particular turret, we send it down to about 600 grit, then we prime it. If you oversend it, it might actually then make it too hard for the primer to catch. So to a moderate amount. Yeah. Any question? Yes.
How many hours for the formula?
Printing.
From start to end, sanding.
I really didn't want to count. But I think if you ask me, I think about 2 or 3 weeks of after print, that means all the component parts, right? It was then about 2 or 3 weeks of further work on it. Something like that. Yeah. It's a bit hard to count because we were printing halfway, then starting to send some of the parts, and then it's a kind of like a moving process. And Jason will know, Jason. Yeah, sorry, you have a question? Maybe the guy at the back first? Yeah, we'll come to you, right?
Yeah, have you thought of mechanizing it?
Ah, this is a good question. People have actually raised that quite a fair bit. They thought of mechanizing, they want to put lights in it, put somebody said they want to put a camera in it. We really want to do that. Perhaps for future projects, because we don't really have the skill set. We haven't really picked up a lot of things yet. Maybe we'll learn a lot more from Jason, we'll hear from him later, and Leon on how to do that. So far, our projects are aesthetic only. They look, they can turn, but we need human to turn. So this one, not very productive.
Just to find out what is the painting cost, like the size, the material, what's the cost, and the design phase included,
or what? Oh, this was one of our own projects. So we didn't really cost it that way. Yeah. You have questions, I'll come back to you. Is it possible to send as... Yes. That means, can we send it and then don't prime, is it? You could, but depending on the type of paint that you use after that, it may or may not stick well. So one of the reasons that we prime is so that it increases paint adhesion for your final layers, that's number one. Number two, is so that we can get, hopefully, a better paint finish on the final surface layer. For example, if you want a very light color, but you print it in a somewhat medium tone filament, it might be hard for your final color to cover. So we normally bring everything down to a gray first, a gray prime state, then we'll paint on top of it. Another reason is because sometimes as we sand, there's a lot of putty, there's some super glue remnants there, we sand it down. It feels smooth, it looks smooth, but we cannot really tell a lot of the surface imperfections until we spray the primer. It brings everything down to a similar white or black surface, then we can see more clearly where we need more work. So sometimes, although what I showed was quite linear, you know, drawing pieces, putty, sand, spray, normally it's quite a to and fro, iterative process. We will spray it, we will look at it, it's not too great, we'll putty again, and sand again. Not happy, come back and go again. So it really depends. I do that less. Jeanette does that a lot. Like, project never finish, right? she knows what I'm talking about.
Sorry,
yeah. Yeah, sure, go ahead.
Is it possible to print rubber?
Is it possible to print rubber? Okay. Not that I know of, not as a pure rubber, but there are flexible filaments out there that you can print, and the end result comes out flexible. You can bend and everything. Things like nylon, TPU, you can print in those. Of course, those are a little more finicky to work with than plastics. So they do exist, flexible filaments. Not exactly rubber, I guess, but yeah. Are there any other questions? Because I think now we can move on. That's it. All right, so like I said, do feel free to come forward. I'd love to share like more in depth some of the things that we've worked on and some of the details. Maybe we can chat more if you're a bit shy just not to ask questions or so. All right, thank you.